Good morning. Welcome to First Christian Church of Lansing. Whether you're here in person or joining us online, we are so glad you are spending this absolutely gorgeous Sunday morning with us. A few housekeeping items before we begin. We offer communion every single Sunday at First Christian Church. So at that time, you can come forward if you would like and take a piece of bread and dip it into the cup. If you'd rather to be served individual serving, that is totally fine too. Stay seated and a deacon will come and offer it to you. If you would rather not partake at all, that's fine too. You do you. If you need a gluten-free option, we do have individual servings of that out in the narthex too, by where you can get the bulletins. By the main doors where you come in is an offering plate, so that is not only where you can leave your offerings, but also your prayer requests. If you need to write those down for us, there's yellow cards in the back of the pew, and if you drop that in the plate during the service, we collect those and read those during prayer time. If you're joining us at home, we want to absolutely make sure we're praying for you as well, so leave those prayer requests in the comments of the feed. We'll write those down for you so we can pray for you while you are at home. First Christian Church is an open and affirming church. That means that we love all, we value all, we want all, just as Jesus would do, and we celebrate everybody on where they are in this journey in life. So please now stand if you are able and join us in singing "As Long as I Have You," followed by "Sweetly Broken." Three, four, one, two.
Oh, Our first scripture reading today is Luke 24:13-31. The same day of Jesus' two disciples were going to the village of Emmaus, which was about 11 kilometers from Jerusalem. As they were talking and thinking about what had happened, Jesus came near and started walking along beside them. But they did not know who he was. Jesus asked them, "What were you talking about as you walked along?" The two of them stood there looking sad and gloomy. Then the one named Cleopas asked Jesus, "Are you the only person from Jerusalem who didn't know what was happening there the last few days?" "What do you mean?" Jesus asked. They answered, "Those things that happened to Jesus from Nazareth, by what he did, and he showed them that he was a powerful prophet who pleased God and all the people." Then the chief priests and our leaders had him arrested and sentenced to die on a cross. We had hoped that he would be the one to set Israel free. But it has already been 3 days since all of this happened. Some women in our group surprised us. They had gone to the tomb early in the morning, but did not find the body of Jesus. They came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he is alive. Some men from our group went to the tomb and found it was just as the woman had said. But they didn't see Jesus either. Then Jesus asked the two disciples, "Why can't you understand? How can you be so slow to believe all the prophets said? Did you know that the Messiah would have to suffer before he was given his glory?" Then Jesus explained everything written about himself in the scriptures, beginning with the law of Moses and the book of the prophets. When the two men came near the village where they were going, Jesus seemed to be going farther. They begged him, "Stay with us. It's already late and the sun is going down." So Jesus went to the house to stay with them. After Jesus sat down to eat, he took some bread and blessed it and broke it, and then he gave it to them. At once they knew who it was, but he disappeared.
I know, you're 88 years old. I saw the
photo.
Oh, no, that's Warren that's 88. You're nine. She's nine. She's 9 years old. I remember being nine. No, I don't remember being nine. We heard in our story today about two people who were walking along a road, and they were very sad about what happened to Jesus. And so somebody came up and talked to them and tried to explain to them who Jesus really was, but they were still very sad. I have a picture that someone gave me that kind of reminds me of that story. It's a story about somebody walking with Jesus and him talking with them. Now, some of us, you know, have a little trouble walking sometimes. And sometimes we have crutches. Sometimes we have a walker.
Sometimes we have a wheelchair.
Sometimes we have a wheelchair.
Like my grandma.
Sometimes we have a cane. When I went this past week to Grand Rapids to see the Chinese Lantern Festival, and most of it was uphill. And I had a great difficulty walking. In fact, somebody had to push me up on a wheelchair part of the way because it was very difficult. So when we talk about walking with Jesus, we think about you have to be big and strong and have a lot of energy to do that. But sometimes walking with Jesus means walking in our struggles. Walking when we're sad. Talking to Jesus when we're sad. Talking to God when we don't feel happy about stuff. Walking with Jesus when it's difficult to walk sometimes. Now, I don't know what kind of songs that you sing at Camp Crystal, but we had one song that we used to sing at Camp Christian in Ohio that I want to try to sing with you if I can remember the chords. My God and I go through the fields together. We walk and talk as good friends should and do. We clasp our hands, our voices ring with laughter. My God and I go through the meadows hue. We clasp our hands, our voices ring with laughter. God and I go through the meadows, you. It went so well in rehearsal. But the words are, my God and I go through the fields together. We walk and talk as good friends should and do. We clasp our hands. Our voices ring with laughter. My God and I go through the meadows, you. It's easy to walk with somebody when they're holding your hand. And sometimes it's good to hold hands, especially if you're going across a busy road, right?
Like with your mom.
Sometimes it's good to, or when your mother or father grab your hand and try to get you to move a little faster, or when somebody's helping you because you can't walk very well. Yeah.
I like my mom grab my arm.
You do? That's good. What's important to remember is that through all things that we go through, God is with us. And even when those two disciples didn't realize it was Jesus, God was still with them. So let's pray. Lord, you walk with us through all things. Walk with us through our times together with you. Even if we're struggling when we walk or having difficulty knowing it's you, walk beside us and give us strength. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our second scripture is Luke 24, 32 through 48. They said to each other, when he talked with us along the road and explained the scriptures to us, didn't it warm our hearts? So they got up and returned to Jerusalem. The two disciples found the 11 apostles and the others gathered together. And they learned from the group that the Lord was really alive and he had appeared to Peter. Then the disciples from Emmaus told what happened on the road and how they knew he was the Lord when he broke the bread. While Jesus' disciples were talking about what had happened, Jesus appeared and greeted them. They were frightened and terrified because they thought they were seeing a ghost. But Jesus said, "Why are you so frightened? Why do you have doubt? Look at my hands and my feet and see who I am. Touch me and find out for yourselves. Ghosts don't have flesh and bones as you see I have." After Jesus said this, he showed them his hands and his feet, and the disciples were so glad and amazed that they could not believe it. Jesus then asked them, "Do you have something to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate it as they watched. Jesus said to them, "While I was still with you, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the book of prophets, and in the Psalms had to happen." Then he helped them understand the scriptures. He told them, "The scriptures say that the Messiah must suffer. Then 3 days later, he will rise from death. They also say that all people of every nation must be told in my name to turn to God in order to be forgiven. So beginning in Jerusalem, you must tell everything that has happened."
I'm doing a series from now till Pentecost on churches of particular people. Some of these are real churches, some of these probably aren't. But that's okay because everybody is a part of the family of God. And I've mentioned to you before that when you read a name in Scripture, it's important to remember that that person was important to the early church. They knew who they were or knew of them. That's why their name is there. We heard about Thomas. We all have heard of Thomas before and the churches that he started in India. But today we learned about a man named Cleopas. Cleopas, what an odd name. But it is actually a derivative of the name Cleopatra, one who means one who's filled with glory. Some say that he was the second husband of Mary, the mother of Jesus. Some people say that he was actually the father of one of the Jameses of the apostles, James the son of Alphaeus. He was actually Alphaeus. But we don't know for sure. And it doesn't really matter. Because for us, it's not important that we have the relic of the shoe of Cleopas to open our church with. It's important for us to have a sense of what this person went through and what that could mean for us. When we walk in our daily lives, Jesus is always walking with us, even when we don't know it. Because God is always present. I heard a comedian once say that you can graduate from school because pretending that it's 10 years out from school, and I will teach you the things that you need to learn that you'll remember 10 years after school. Spanish, ¿cómo está usted? Theology, God is everywhere. That would be nice if we believed that God is everywhere. Because God is always present. We see God in nature. A lot of people were out this week with funny glasses on looking up at the sky. People spend a lot of time and a lot of money going to places where they could see a total eclipse. If you want to wait to see a total eclipse, kind of wait until about 8, 9 o'clock at night. You can see one every night. I even had an app on my phone that would let me look at the eclipse on my phone. Then I had another one that was called NBC that let me look at pictures of it later on my phone. We wound up going to my sister-in-law's house, and she and her husband had glasses because we waited too long to get glasses and everybody sold out. But we went and sat with them and looked at the 98% total eclipse and thought, wow, how cool. Did we think about God in that? Think about ancient times when events like that happened and people thought maybe it was God's curse on us. Or maybe we were fighting in a battle and it thought that it was God's way of helping us to complete the battle. We look to nature to find God. And it seems that there's something about nature that draws us to the divine. There's a lot of discussions among people in science, and I'm a big follower of science. I'm a big follower of people who follow science. And one of the things that it's important to remember is that a long time ago, religion used to be a part of science. It used to be called the queen of the sciences. Now, that led to a lot of problems. People who thought that the world was flat, if you think that, we'll talk later. And that the sun revolved around the earth. But there's a lot in science and religion and belief in God that are the same. I don't know if you're a fan of the TV show Young Sheldon, but Sheldon likes to get after Pastor Jeff a lot about his stuff. But one time, his mother, Mary, is having a struggle of faith. And Sheldon says these really important words for a scientist of somebody who says he doesn't believe in God. Did you know that if gravity was just a little bit stronger, life wouldn't be able to be formed? And if gravity was a little bit weaker, we would never be able to stay on the planet. And that there are 7 billion people in the world. And God chose for me the mother who would be best to understand me. Sometimes God can be found in nature if we look past what we see just on the end of our noses. God is in our sacred places. How many of you have been to Camp Crystal? Feel like a sacred place? In reality, it's just a place. But what makes it sacred? We go looking for God there. God is no more there than God is at Kroger. Maybe less so, because people really need God in Kroger. If God is everywhere, God is in all things. God is in nature. We had a group of people because Camp Christian in Ohio was right in the middle of the total eclipse. A lot of people went there and drove there and stayed there and cooked hot dogs and had s'mores and shared fellowship and waited for the world to get dark for a few minutes and then get light again. And while that's a miraculous event, what was sacred about it was the people getting together and talking and being in a place where they felt the presence of God and learning and understanding that they were together for God and with God. Have you ever been in a huge cathedral? I remember the first time I walked into St. Paul's in London. Huge cathedral. Great paintings on the walls. Huge pulpit rising up into the sky. Beautiful architecture. And the first thing I thought was I wouldn't want to preach from here because nobody would be listening to me. I was lucky enough to go to the Sistine Chapel. And it is an ADHD nightmare. Let me tell you, there are paintings on every square inch. And the famous painting of God and Adam is on way, way up there, and it's so small. You can't see the detail. And there are things up there that are painted in detail that you can't see unless you get close to it, because it's not necessarily meant for us to see. But I felt as close to God in places like that as I have in my home church, in a small chapel somewhere. I did a wedding once a long time ago for a couple, and it was in an old country church, and it was so old that the lights were attached to the ceiling fan. And it got really warm, and the only way to cool it down was to turn the ceiling fans on that, of course, turned the lights on. So it really didn't help much. But what made it special was not the timber and the wood, was not the blessing that it received, but the people who brought God there and who saw God there. That's what made it sacred. That's what made it special. God is everywhere, even in the valley of the shadow of death, even when we get close to the end of life. We can see God in the face of a newborn baby. But when we have trouble walking, sometimes it's hard to bless God. We can see God in great celebrations, but it's hard to see God when you're sitting by somebody's bedside, or even when you're the one in the bed. But it's important to know that God is with us through it all. God did not leave Cleopas and the other disciple in their pain, but walked with them and explained to them and heard their struggle and helped them to understand. And more than a story of an event, it is a metaphor for how God is with us. Because sometimes when we're walking along, somebody's talking to us, and we don't realize that God is helping them say the right things for us. Sometimes we don't know that God is using us to share the right words with other people. The disciples didn't know it was Jesus, but he was on their minds. He was, when he said, "What's going on?" The only thing they could think of that whole week, that whole Passover week, was, "Are you the only one who hasn't heard what happened?" Even in death, Jesus was the most important person to them. Now, we know the story. We know it was Jesus, but they didn't know it was Jesus. They knew that their hearts were grieving because the one who they put all their faith in let them down. They put all their faith in this man and he let them down. He didn't really let them down, did he? Because he continued to walk with them and talk with them as good friends should and do. When he walked with them, they didn't know it was him. We all have struggles and we have to look for Jesus, not in order to make him come to us, but to realize that he's there in whatever struggles we endure. And to know that other people can be God's comfort to us and that we can be God's comfort to others. And even after he appeared to them and they knew it was him, they continued walking. They didn't keep the secret to themselves. He came to them, he broke bread with them, he shared bread with them, and he disappeared. And the first thing they could think of was, "We got to tell these people that we heard this story about that it's true." Because you still got to walk. I was about halfway up John Ball Hill when I was looking for an escape hatch. And I was hoping there was, but there wasn't. So my wife and Emily and some guy who worked at the park pushed me up part of the hill, got to the top. I rode down part of it myself, scaring everybody as we went quickly down the hill. But you continue to go. My knees are killing me today, which is why I have a stick with me today. But I'm not letting that stop me from walking. Maybe you feel sad today. Maybe you feel like God doesn't love you and nobody loves you and you're going to go and eat some worms or something. And that's okay. Keep walking. Jesus shared hospitality with those who gathered with him. They invited him in. It was late. "Come stay with us. Come eat with us." Because that's what Jewish tradition says. In Deuteronomy 10:19, it says, "You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." It's important for us to show hospitality to one another. It's important to show hospitality and to be a part of that experience. Romans 12:13 says, "Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers." I know you think we have a coffee hour because we just can't wait to go out and have donuts and crackers and coffee. But we do it because it's an act of fellowship and love. It's an act of hospitality. It's an act of worship to share with other people. Because we could go to Wendy's, have some chili, right, Doug? We go have some chili at Wendy's. But it's not about the food. It's about the fellowship. And we can worship anywhere. Church events are good, but they're not a substitute. It's good to have fellowship activities. It's good for us to have activities to welcome people in, but it's not a substitute for worship. Authentic worship is holy worship. And that's not a style. Because we all have different styles. We all like different kinds of styles. I didn't realize how much fun bluegrass worship was till I came here. It's not a style I was used to, but I love it. Because style is a way we express it. Worship is what we do. Style of music is just a style. You can play the ukulele badly and mess up the chords and the words a bit. But if you're doing it for worship, it is the most blessed sound to God there is. It's worship of God by our spirits that is the blessing. I've never found a church of Cleopas before. I don't imagine there is one. We just don't know enough about it, and it's not flashy enough. Everybody wants to go to St. Peter's. Everybody wants to go to St. Joseph. Everybody wants to go to St. James. But who wants to go to St. Cleopas? Sounds like somebody's cousin from Kentucky, doesn't it? But maybe we should be the Church of St. Cleopas. Because if we had a mission statement, if we were the Saint of Cleopas, it would go something like this. You never know when Jesus might be talking to you. You never know when Jesus might be walking with you. So treat everybody like they are Jesus. Cleopas offered hospitality to a stranger, not knowing that it was Jesus, and so too our mission must be one of service. Remember the joy that they had in seeing and knowing it was Jesus, and may our every day be a day of joy and excitement. Amen. So now we stand to sing our hymn of prayer, Just a Closer Walk with the number 557.
Thank you. It's our time of prayer. If you could bow your head. Dear Lord, we all have joys, we all have sorrows. Help us to focus on the joys in life and the positives. We do know that there's always things that need help. Throughout the world, one country is mad at another. One country is fighting another. We ask that you would help to resolve the conflicts. In our congregation, the Biebers, Shelters, and McAvoys want to pray for the Eversole family on the passing of their father and husband, Bob, after a short battle with cancer. From Nicole, for Brian Sorby, who is being airlifted from Escanaba to Green Bay after complications during a surgery for a perforated ulcer and twisted intestines. For Eli, his friend's son, Tom Veer, who was hit by a car while riding his bicycle. For Jill, continued prayers for Lynn Blackmore. She has put up a brave fight against cancer and now has hospice. Her spirit is strong, but her body is not. For Warren Walrath and his son, the son has had some heart issues recently. For Bev Ressler, who will be having two heart surgeries in this upcoming week. And we have a prayer of praise for Joyce Cox, as her son Andrew and his girlfriend Emily are with us now. Lord, as we stay silent for a minute, let us lift up the prayers that we didn't bring forward. As we continue with the Lord's Prayer. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our communion hymn is a song of one who walks beside us. It's number 231.
Living.
It is significant that the story of Cleopas concludes with Jesus breaking bread with them. It's an act of hospitality that Jesus was shared with, that the food was shared with him, but an act of deliverance that when he took the bread and blessed it and broke it, that they knew it was him. When we come around the table, when we share in the bread, it is God's blessing to us. All are welcome. You are always invited because it is Christ who invites. So if you choose to, please come forward and share in the meal. Please come forward and share together in the fellowship. You don't have to. Nicole said that. She told us we don't have to if you don't want to. But don't feel like you can't. Because you can. Because Jesus laid the meal out for us. The night he was betrayed, he took bread and blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." When supper was ended, he took a cup and again he gave thanks and he said, "Take all of you and drink from this. For this is my blood of the covenant poured out for you. Do this as often as you eat and drink in memory of me."
Lord, we need you in our lives. We need your strength and your support. As we partake of these elements, we ask that you would help to replenish your spirit in our lives, that we might be able to reflect that in this upcoming week as we go through the days. Amen.
before we sing our final hymn, I want to remind you that I am going to be on vacation this week, and Eli will be preaching next Sunday. Yay! And next Sunday is Camp Sunday, so make sure you come and be a part of that, and there will be wild celebrations in the street. So make sure you're available here for that. Also, next Sunday is board meeting, yes? So make sure if you want to come to that, you come to that. Now, before we sing our final hymn, I want to offer you the opportunity, if you want to join this church, join this fellowship, to come forward during the hymn. If you want to profess your faith in preparation for baptism, we invite you to come forward and do that. If you want to rededicate your life to Christ, we invite you to come forward during the our singing of Today is the Day. Please stand in body or spirit.
3, 4. Knowing that
now let us go forth in love and share the good news that Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. And we will share his love. And the blessing of God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit go with you today, tomorrow, the next day, the next day, the next day, and forever. And all the church said,
Amen.
Amen.